Welcome back, children. Today we are going to learn a new poem. Now, you know our national animal, right? Before it was a lion and now it is the tiger, right? So now we are going to start about a tiger in the zoo. So this is the title of our poem, Tiger in the Zoo. Now, everybody knows that there is a lockdown and you are staying at home and you are confined to your house, right? So, how are you feeling? Are you happy that you are confined to the room or maybe to your house, or sad because you are unable to come to school and be with your friends? So, just think for some time and tell me your answers. Some may say we are very happy. Some may say no ma'am, we want to come back to school. Right. So what do you think has happened? That means your freedom is restricted. So here coming to our tiger who is in the zoo. Actually it had to be in its own habitat, and that is the wild jungle. So when we say a tiger in the zoo, this is a small poem. We have the poet here, Leslie Norris, who has given us a message through this poem, A Tiger in the Zoo, contrasting the habitat of the tiger and where it is confined to. So let us see the poem. A little script about your poet, Leslie Norris, who is born in 1921 and died in 2006. He is a famous poet and a short story writer. He became famous with his first publication, that is Finding Go. So this is what we have information regarding Leslie Norris. Now children, we want to view a small clip regarding a tiger in the zoo.
A tiger in the zoo. The central idea of the poem is importance of natural habitat and the resulting freedom, which is very much necessary for natural living and blooming of true personality. But in the opposite conditions, the same animal loses interest and feels suffocated, even if we give it the artificial settings. The caged animal almost fails to be seen the way it is known for. The tiger is a proud creature. Whenever you see the tiger, you can see that it is very proud. It is a shame that such a powerful, agile and untamable animal should be caged in a zoo. In his natural and wild habitat, he doesn't need help of any kind to hunt its own food. His hunting of deer at the waterhole may seem rather cruel. He hunts not for pleasure, but for food. His presence in the natural habitat is necessary to maintain the balance of the food chain, as we all know about the ecosystem. Sometimes the tiger may stray into human habitation and terrorize people, but he only displays his strength and ferociousness, but he doesn't harm anyone till he is provoked. Even in the cage, he ignores all those who come to the zoo to see him as an entertainment. Like human beings, the tiger too loves and values his freedom. He shows his anger, hatred, and even defiance by walking about in rage in his cage. Human progress should not be at the cost of destroying the natural habitats of untamable and proud animals like the tiger. So now you are going to read the poem, A Tiger in the Zoo. The tiger is not in his natural habitat, as you can see. The wilds or the jungle is the natural habitat of the tiger. Unfortunately, the forest has been confined to a cage. habitat in a zoo. He is no more free to roam about in the forest, but walks within the length and breadth of his cage. He has dark lines on his skin, which are clearly visible even from a distance. Condemned to live in his cage, he walks around quietly with his velvety soft feet. He is angry but has to suppress it. In his quiet rage, he continues walking up and down his caged habitat. The poet imagines how the tiger should behave if he is in his natural habitat, the wild jungle. There he should be silently hiding himself behind in the shadow and remains unnoticed. Sliding through the long grass, he should move steadily to ambush his prey. He knows where he can find his kill in the wild. His favorite hunt is the plum deer, which he can find near the water hole. Sometimes he comes out of the forest and strays in human settlement at the edge of the jungle. There he terrorizes the villagers by opening out his white fangs or the long teeth and the claws. His ferocious looks frighten the villagers. However, he has no intention of entering the village and killing anybody till he is highly provoked. Unfortunately, the mighty tiger is cursed to live in a concrete cell in the zoo. Many visitors come to him to see him in the zoo, but he doesn't like the stares of the visitors. He simply ignores their presence. Now, he is made to limit his movements only to the length and breadth of his caged habitat. The tiger keeps awake till late in the night, hears the noise of the patrolling cars moving around in the zoo. The brilliant stars shine in the sky and his brilliant eyes shine in the night. He can't free himself, but he keeps on watching the brilliant stars standing behind the bars of his caged habitat. So this is what is going to be explained in the lesson.
Children, you must have got the gist of the poem. Now in detail we are going to learn. Firstly, a tiger in the zoo. Right? Actually, the habitat of the tiger is the jungle or the forest. Jungle or the forest. Right? But we have confined the animal, this proud animal, to a cage. So just imagine the anger it must be feeling. So our poet has given a message where the tiger is a powerful animal, it wants to show its power, but now it is totally in a caged room and is not allowed to move about freely. Whereas freedom is our birthright. So imagine, children, if you are in a room and nobody is allowing you to move out and you are given everything, whatever you require, but you are not supposed to go out. How does it feel? So the same situation is there for the tiger. So he stalks. Now let us start with the first stanza. He stalks. Now who is this he? The tiger we are talking about. And here, earth tiger, right? Earth tiger, when we say, here you can say article A and the. The in particular zoo and a tiger, a tiger. We are not talking about a particular tiger, but from the group or the herd, we are talking about a tiger. So here, we are talking about a tiger in the zoo. So he stalks in his vivid stripes. Who is he? He is the tiger. Stalks, walks out very proudly. Walks about very proudly. Stalks in his vivid stripes. In his vivid stripes. Vivid, very bright. Stripes, everybody knows the lines on the body of the tiger. The few steps of his cage. the few steps of his cage. That means he is totally confined to that particular cage. So, a few steps of his cage. On pads of velvet white. Now, on pads of velvet white, see, they are having cushion-like paws. So, in that way, compared to, see, pads of velvet white is, pads of velvet white is a metaphor, right? It is telling about the softness of the paw. In his quiet rage, now he may be quiet, but he is very much angry. The way he is moving about, it shows that he is very much angry but unable to show his anger. So here, rage is anger. Quiet is silent. Rage, anger. So here he stops. That means he is moving about in his cage. He is the majestic animal, we can see. Very proud. He walks a few steps in his cage on his paws and he is very, very angry but cannot show his anger. That is why he is quiet. So here, children, we can see for the poetic devices which we call. The first one, here we can say personification. Personification. Now, what is personification? When the quality of a human is being described, right? To an animal or a thing, it is personification. So, when we are saying he, always we refer to animals as it. But here the poet is telling he. So, it is personification. Now, what is the rhyming scheme? Second one is the rhyming scheme. Now, rhyming scheme. How do we rhyme them? Let us see. Stripes, cage, quiet, rage. So, here we say stripes. Let me put it as A. This as B. This as C. Now, let us see which word is rhyming. Right? Which line is rhyming? Here, we can say cage. So, the words are cage and rage. So, we give it a B. So, this is how the rhyming scheme goes. So now what is the rhyming scheme? A, B, C, B. So throughout the poem if you see, the rhyming scheme is the same. Next one, we have enjambment. Now what is this enjambment? It's a new word. And enjambment is nothing but when the sentence flows into the next sentence and continues without a full stop or a comma, it is known as enjambment. So children, if you can see, here we don't have any comma or a full stop. He stops in his vivid strides the few steps of his cage. So is there any comma or full stop? No. Till cage. So we can say that this is enjambment. Fine? Understood, everybody? So this is what is our poetic device which we call. So we have few: personification, rhyming scheme and enjambment in this total stanza. We have one more thing, that is metaphor. Metaphor is nothing but comparisons without the use of as and like. So here comparison of velvet, right? Velvet quiet. That means comparison with the cushion. Okay, and the smoothness of velvet. So that is nothing but our metaphor. And finally we have oxymoron. Now what is this oxymoron? Oxymoron. When two words are opposite to each other and they come together. Okay, here we can see quiet and rage. Quiet in the sense without making any noise. And rage is anger. Can you be silent when you are angry? No. So, quiet, rage. So, this is nothing but two opposite words. One more example I can give you. Deafening silence. Deafening silence. So that is nothing but oxymoron. Such type of words are known as oxymoron. So children, did you all understand what happened here? The tiger is confined to his cage, moving about, cannot do anything, cannot show his power. Okay? So children, we'll stop here.